This episode of The Train is brought to you by Coach's Oats. Coach's Oats was invented by Lynn Rogers, the head women's gymnastics coach at Cal State Fullerton for 24 years. Coach liked the nutritional benefits of a bowl of oatmeal, but disliked that mushy texture. So he did what any good coach would do and went back to the basics. The result was a whole grain oatmeal that yields the hearty texture and natural flavor of steel-cut oats, but cooks in just 3 to 5 minutes. Coach patented that cracked and toasted oats and has been fueling athletes for more than 25 years. So let it supply the energy you need to outplay the day with Coach's Oats. Well, this is episode 3 of the pod, episode 3 of the train. And, you know, 3 in a row, we got another really special guest. His name is Michael Brinegar. And he's swimming over at Indiana, and he's doing some really cool things, not just in the respective sport of swimming itself, but, you know, open water swimming. And he's kind of had a really cool journey to get there. So he's here on the show. He's going to talk his journey to get to where he's at right now and, you know, just doing some really cool things, like I said, in the sport. And, you know, we're going to dive into Michael Brinegar and just really get to learn a little bit about him and, you know, kind of what his daily routine is, what he does, you know, things he likes to eat. So we got a good show for you. So with no further ado, Michael Brinegar. Welcome to the show, Michael Brinegar. Okay, how you doing today?
Good, how are you doing?
Good, man. Walk us through your day. What did you do today?
I had weights this morning, and then I took a two-hour nap after that, went to two of my classes, my English and math class, and then had lunch, relaxed before afternoon practice. Today was challenge set. And then basically just been relaxing since then.
What's COVID like? Are you guys in classes right now?
They're all online.
Okay, all online. And what do you eat for breakfast? Like, what's your diet? What's your diet looking like these days, Michael?
Well, to be honest, I have Frosted Flakes every morning for breakfast.
Oh my gosh, that's the first step. It's got to change. It's got to be Coach's Oats. It's got to be the oatmeal grind.
It's just what gets me through that, like, helps me get through morning practice. Like, no, they're like cereal. Like, it just takes one bowl and then I'm good to go. Like,
they're more cereal than good. You got to finish it. There we go. All right. So Frosted Flakes. All right. So you Frosted Flakes. Then what? What's after practice?
After practice, we have our nutrition center, which is like still open. They like have stuff for us to pick up, and they have a really good like vegan breakfast sandwich, so I get that, and then like
are you
an
Uncrustable.
No,
it's just okay. Like,
yeah, so I get that, and then Uncrustable and a protein shake.
Okay.
And then okay. I'll like be after practice, and then I'll have some like Clif bars, like as snacks throughout the day, and then lunch will be something that they have there at like the nutrition center again, usually. So it's like some kind of meat, like chicken or a steak or a burger. And then some kind of carbs, like they have like mac and cheese or pasta. And then some like vegetables, like carrots or broccoli.
Wow, that was really descriptive. Yeah. I like that. And that's all through lunch and dinner and stuff like that.
Yeah, and then, like, again, like, I'll have a Clif bar and have, like, some Gatorade and water with practice, and then I'll go back there again for dinner, and it's, like, the same thing for dinner.
Yeah, dude, you got to get that camera lifted up. We're missing half your chin. We need to see all your face right here. Okay, we need to see the stud that is. So yeah. I guess what I'm asking, have you dove super into, you know, you see all those crazy athletes that dive into these, you know, these diets. Are you really watching what you eat right now, or is it pretty much just you're feeling the tank?
I'm feeling the tank, just making sure I fill myself up and get everything I need to, so I'm not like hungry or like losing weight because all the yardage and yardage I do.
Yeah, you got to get to that that super elite diet. That's what all the crazy athletes are doing. That's the next thing. I think college is changing, and you know, even when I was growing up, I don't think diet was pushed as hard as it is today. In a sense that now you're seeing all these crazy athletes going all these, you know, plant-based diets and stuff like that. So you got to check that out. You got to check that out. See if the diet can do anything for you. That's the next step. That's the next evolution. in Michael Brinegar's face. Okay, sweet. So, you know, it sounds like you're staying busy, and I like that with COVID. Are restrictions bumping back up in Indiana?
Not that, like, I think in other areas, yes. I think Purdue, they've been, like, shutting stuff down. But, like, other than that, other schools, I'm not really sure. But, like, our school, we haven't had anything, like, shutting down again yet. So everything's fine right now.
Dude, it's getting kind of gnarly back in California. Like, everything's I don't really know. It's like going back on lockdown. I don't really know this whole COVID thing. I was thinking about starting this podcast off with a mask on, like doing the Joe Biden thing where I show up with the mask on and then like I take it off right as we get started. Okay, so no, we had Herbie Bem on, you know, last week. Did you get to listen to that pod?
No, I haven't been able to.
Oh yet. My gosh. No, you're not allowed to say that. On the pod, you got to say we watched it. Yo, we'll reclip that. We'll reclip it. We'll do like a lip over where it's like you just okay. You gotta hype up the pod. We gotta pretend we watch it. So don't worry, we'll fake the voice and we'll get the clipped over. Right. So we talked about getting Michael Phelps for week four, but we got Michael Brinegar. We're still stoked. So let's fire it up. We talked earlier on the phone today. I did my research, I did my homework. I swam with you for a little bit. I should know, but my memory's fading. So let's get this straight. Okay. I'm just going to dive into your intro and then, you know, you can kind of fill in as we go. And, eventually I'll just let you take over. Okay. Cause they don't want to hear me talk. They want to hear you talk. All the listeners out there. Oh, did you talk to Simon? We got to get Simon on the pod.
Yeah. I talked to him. He said that'd be awesome. He'd want to be on it.
He's ready. Where's he at right now? Is he back in California?
He's in California. Yeah.
Okay. Good. Okay. Also for this pod, if you're listening right now, we're going to try something different. Where, you know, Michael's a big time gamer out here. So we're going to hop on the sticks at the end of this pod. Hopefully we can get this up. Hopefully we're tech savvy and we can get the clips of us playing. I think we're going to go Fortnite. I think Fortnite's a game. We'll explain a little bit of that as we go. But I think we're going to try that. But glad to hear you're doing well. Let's get back to this intro. Okay, so you swam or you grew up as an age group in Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And your mom, she swam for Mark Schubert. You know, back in the day. So she was kind of your first link. And then after your freshman year of Indiana, you decided to come out to Huntington Beach for a summer and give it a shot with Mark. Soon after, okay, after that summer, you went back to Indiana and swam there for a year. Again, correct me if I'm wrong on any of these things, but I don't think I am. You went back to Indiana for a year, trained there all year, had a pretty successful year. But then, you know, coming in 2016 now, you decided for your last 2 years of high school, you wanted to come back out to California and train with Mark those last 2 years. What was kind of going through your head during that decision? Was that kind of were you pushing for that? Was, you know, did your parents really want that? Were they supportive? And, you know, kind of what's that like? That's a big step to make.
You know, I originally it was at the end of my freshman year, the coach that I'd been swimming with was retiring. So my mom like started coaching me, but we didn't really work too well together. I mean, like we did work well together. It was just, she thought she needed like some extra like workouts or something like to help me get me going. And she asked Mark for those workouts. So I did that like at the end of my freshman year, and then going into the summer, she like suggested I go out there and like train with them, see what that's like. And I really enjoyed it, but I really wanted to stay home. So I spent my sophomore year back here in Indiana, but I was training by myself every day. So that was just really tough. So then after that, I was like my junior year, I was like, I really just want to go out there and be able to train with other people and be there in person with Mark. You know, my parents were super supportive. They just wanted whatever was best for me. And I was just like really grateful that I was able to go out there and train with Mark. And yeah, it was really good.
Yeah. And it's really cool. I know you've made some really good connections and you still keep in touch with a lot of guys you met out here. So, you know, blessing in disguise that you got out here and you were able to swim with Mark and, you know, really succeed those last 2 years of high school. Like you really, really bloomed. I think my first kind of moment where I was like, yeah, this dude's legit was you came in to swim with us in high school and I was a few years older than you. But I think we had this like Huntington Beach pier swim, right? Do you remember that?
Oh yeah. Which one are you talking about though?
I think, did I beat you the first year and then you took me down the second year, right? I think you were like 14 and I was like 17. So I should have taken you down. But it was something like you had never grown up by the beach. And yeah. my whole game was, all right, like, I just got to get out, get past the waves. And, you know, I'll catch a wave in. It's basically half the race is basically just battling the waves, right?
Yeah.
And then once you yeah. get out there, it's all choppy and stuff like that. And you had never really, like, seen the ocean because you're from Indiana. So you got lakes, and that's about, you know, the closest you'll get. But I remember that race that morning. We went out and, you know, I got a solid lead just right out the get, you know, going under those waves. And sure enough, like 4 minutes later, because the race only lasts like 12 minutes, you know, 10, 12 minutes.
Yeah.
4 or 5 minutes later, I look back and I see this guy just like muscling his way just all the way through. And then he finally catches me. He loops the corner. And at this point, I'm just toast. You're dusting me. But there was no stop. It was like the same pace the whole way. And you weren't going to lose. You're just going to muscle your way to the top. I was probably trash talking that whole time. I probably got what I deserve. You smoked me. But I think that was the first time where I'm like, oh my gosh, dude, like, this kid's legit. And, you know, I think you've proven something else, that you're not just an open water swimmer. I mean, you can do it in the pool too. You battled it out at NC's, you know, a couple years ago. Well, you know what? We'll wait to get into that. Let's just kind of jump back in. You know, you come out of high school, had a super good, successful 2 years with Mark. Was it weird? Like, were you just completely focused in on swimming? Because now, you know, you kind of have those outside distractions gone. And who was it that hosted you again? What family was it?
The Del Rosario family.
Yeah, shout out them. They're a really awesome family. But when you were living yeah. there, those 2 years, your last 2 years of high school, was it kind of like you were just, you know, there swimming, they fed you, they gave you a place? Or were you like, were you really part of the family? You're jumping in, you're doing chores, you're cleaning the dishes. You know, there's limits on game time. You got to go to bed. What is it? You're young, dude. You're like 16 when you did this.
Yeah. I mean, like, when I first moved in, it was just like, they were hosting me and stuff. And like, they were kind enough to like make dinner and like provide like food for me to make myself, like breakfast and lunch. But they would always cook dinner for me. And like, sometimes I would cook dinner too, but you know, like, it was just really great. Like, I really became a part of the family, and it was like, really couldn't have been like with a better family.
Yeah, that's cool. And I know they had some younger ones, and you could really be a role model to those guys and, you know, really show what hard work is. And I know you're a slobby guy. You must have been hard to live with. They really put a lot on their shoulders there.
Yeah, I mean, the first like year and a half, yeah, it was like really bad. I mean, I've gotten better.
Like, I would say show us the room right now, but I'm gonna say the listeners, you know,
I mean, honestly, my room's clean right now.
Really? Can we get a look? Can yeah. we get a look at the room? Let's see it. Let's see what the Michael Brinegar setup at Indiana is. This is hype. Welcome to my crib. Okay, yeah. So there's the room. Where's the gaming setup? I know that's a big, there it is. You didn't cop that PS5 yet?
I'm getting the Xbox Series X
one. Oh, that's right. One. You're an Xbox guy. Yeah. Otherwise we'd be playing Madden or FIFA or something like that. But we got to go yeah. Fortnite. We got to go cross play. We just yeah. threw off the old folks listening. We just went straight millennial. Okay, so you kind of had, you know, kind of took you in as a family down there. And I always knew you were an Indiana kid. You were always an Indiana kid growing up. And it must be exciting for you. Their football team this year, they can win. They can win some games.
Yeah, yeah, they are.
COVID's in Indiana's year. You take out, you know, half the competition. They got something to do.
I mean, it's not really half the competition. You just took out their easy schedule. They've been playing all their hard games.
Oh, my. Yeah. Dude, get out of here.
The Big Ten, one of the toughest conferences, and they're 4-0 in it right now.
Yeah, come on now. Have they played Ohio State yet?
That's this weekend.
Yeah, that's right. We'll see what happens. We'll do a second part right after this, after the Ohio State game. We'll cover it live. We'll cover the Ohio State game live. I'm not even a, you know, Iowa State guy. I just, they're nasty. You know their guy Justin Fields out there?
Yeah, it's disgusting. Yeah, I mean, it'll be a tough game, but I mean, IU's been playing incredibly well. I think it'll be a fun game to watch for sure, though.
I hope so. I'm excited. I kind of like, you yeah. know, I miss the fans, but some of the, you know, the silence on field is kind of sick. Yeah, I feel like you're really just watching the game. And they're kind of, yeah. you know, they're skipping through some of those shots where it's like they pan through the fans and they're panning through the end zones and all that stuff. And now it's kind of just, I like the, you know, the dance celly cams when they score. Kind of jumping to NFL right now, but college is just as sick. And, you know, it's kind of cool to see some of these seasons getting up and getting going, you know. Every Saturday you're gonna see about six postponed games, but hey, you always get a couple. You always get a couple. So when you were getting recruited, were you looking at other schools, or were you already committed? You're like, I'm Indiana. Because I know at least when you're young, it was kind of where your mindset was at. But I guess senior year, once you start getting all the other offers and, you know, recruiting trips, you know, there's a lot of tempting things out there that, you know, could persuade you another way.
I mean, honestly, like growing up, I definitely was like, I'm going to IU and all this. But then when I was like going through middle school and like freshman, sophomore year, I like wasn't as interested. I was definitely like really looking into other options. I seriously talked with like Michigan, Louisville, and Tennessee. Those were the other three schools I was talking to.
Yeah.
But then, I mean, honestly, like IU wasn't even my top pick up until Ray Lewis came out, head coach here, came out and visited me in person. And then like, it just like switched back on. It was like, that's where I'm going to be. Like, that's my home. I got to go back.
Wait, you know? That's insane. It's just like,
yeah.
It was like the coming home moment. That's actually really cool. Your parents must have been so happy.
Yeah.
Wait, so it's like so, great to be back. So what was your top school, you know, before I already forgot his name, but you know, that Indiana coach, you know, before he took over, where was your mind heading?
At the time, Tyler Fenwick was coaching at Tennessee, and he's a big open water guy. Like that. And then also Louisville and Michigan, like they're like those three were definitely like closer to like being my top pick. And then IU is there because like I'm from here, and then like it's a really good program and all, but like I don't know, for some reason, I just like wasn't really thinking about IU that seriously.
Yeah, that's really cool. And you know, I was kind of thinking about this actually today. You know, a lot of freshmen, you come in, you know, their first year, and they struggle. You know, it's an adaptive, it's a change. You know, they're probably used to mommy and daddy coming in, cooking for them, and doing all these things. And even if they're doing a lot of that self, a lot of the responsibilities are, you know, taken off their shoulders. But for example, you came in, you know, after living by yourself, I mean, you were with a family, but you know, it kind of was like you were in college. You had some people helping you out, but ultimately you're probably allowed to make a lot of decisions on your own. So going into your freshman year, you probably kind of already had some preparation, some time alone, and just, you know, some real solid time to get ready. So you didn't really have to deal with, you know, that transition into freshman year. You had already been living away from home for a couple of years. And that definitely showed, because your freshman year, you came in and you absolutely just went off. Dude, talk us through your freshman year. And you know, take your time, because that was insane.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly had a kind of rough start, like, with school, because the third week of school I missed the whole third week of school for Junior Worlds in open water.
Yeah.
And so, like, I had some trouble getting back on track with, like, academics and stuff. And then, like, I only took 2 days off. I definitely should have taken more. And I think that made the training a little more difficult at the beginning of the season, because I was still just worn out.
Yeah.
But then right when we hit our midseason meet, I was just, like, starting to, like, train really well. And then I had a decent midseason meet, so that was good. And then getting through finals and all that was just a little difficult, and like trying to balance the swimming and just trying to make sure I didn't get out of shape or anything during that week. And then we had our training trip in Miami. And that was a really good training trip. I did really well. The workouts like were perfect for me that week. And then just coming off of that, just like kept on building and building all the workouts, going to Big Tens. I did a drop rest, but I didn't shave for Big Tens because I was like right off the A cut, so like I was pretty sure I was gonna qualify in the mile.
Yeah.
So I was just going, and then I ended up having a really good Big Tens. I dropped in my 500, I dropped in my mile, and I got second in Big Tens, which was pretty good. And
yeah,
then,
you were like 14:31 in Big Tens, and that was you took second to. I was looking up his name. I can't pronounce it. It's like how do you pronounce his name?
I think it's Albeck.
Albeck, are you guys boys? Like, are you guys close, or you guys talk?
I mean, like, we are, like, he's a really nice guy, but I've only talked to him, like, at a little bit of Big Tens and then a little bit of NCs, but not much other than that. But, like, he's a really nice guy.
No beef?
No beef, no. Like, no beef? He's a great swimmer. Like, I don't know.
Is there
like,
beef?
Really great, like,
Is there beef in the swim community? No, not between you guys. But is there beef? Like, do you know? I mean, I was joking around with Wade in the back the other day. Swim clout is like a thing. Like you have the in on and all the swim clout. I was always the wannabe. Like I swam Division I, but I was never like the super fast guy. I was like the guy who was like good enough to like be friends with, you know, kind of some of the fast people. But you're like right in. Like there's got to be beef. It's competition. There's got to be some beef.
I mean,
and if not there's not, like, there needs to be some.
Well, I mean, like we have beef with like Michigan, like IU and Michigan have beef, but like not like personally with the swimmers. Like I'm friends with like Patrick Allen, who's on the swim team, and I kind of know like a couple of the freshmen on their team this year, but like I don't have like beef with them, but like I just like hate the school, you know?
Yeah, well, that's fair.
Yeah, that's so fair. But like, other than that, like any kind of, I don't know about any other like beef necessarily.
Well,
like,
you're still young. You're still young. You can start some. Make it exciting. Get some exciting beef going down. We'll start it right here. Who you want to call out? Just kidding. We won't do that. We'll keep it clean here on the pod. No, but that's funny. So he took you down at a Big Tens, and then going into NCs, you know, for people that, you know, aren't swimmers, it's really hard to make that transition from, you know, your end season, I guess, conference meet, championship meet, and then going into NCs, which is only a few weeks later, just with tapering, you know, getting rest, you know, how'd you guys do it? Cause you know, talk us through kind of your preparation after Big Tens, and then going into NCs, what was that like?
I mean, right after Big Tens, I just remember, I can't even remember exactly what we did or how long of a break it was. I just remember the first week was just like really difficult. Well, actually, no, it was difficult, but I was like, right. Like I was where I wanted to be with my times and practices. Yeah. And then just hitting, I like got to do a full taper, which was really nice. And then,
for Big Tens or NCs?
For NCs.
Okay. So, yeah.
Like, after, I think it was a week, and then I did the 2 week taper right after that, but like, it was a steady descent in like the yardage and the intensity. Like I can't remember exactly what it was, but then going into NCs, it was, I mean, everybody on the team had a different like thing going on, because they taper differently for Big Tens, or they didn't taper. They have to do a longer, like our sprinters that like might not have tapered for Big Tens, like had to start tapering immediately after Big Tens because they need that longer rest going into NCs. So it's just like completely different off the board.
Yeah, it's super difficult, you know, and especially trying to time a taper, you know, mentally, physically, and being a distance swimmer, you're doing so much yardage, like you don't want to come off too much, because you want to go in that race feeling good and you know, confident in your aerobic abilities. So going into NCs, did you feel real good? Like were you going into NCs knowing that you were going to go, you know, spoiler alert, but you went 14:27 and actually took second to the same guy that beat you at Big Tens. That's what I'm talking about. You guys have that little rivalry going now. It's time to bring it back. So he's still in college, right?
No, he graduated last year.
No.
Is
he swimming ISL right now?
Yeah, he's swimming ISL. He's swimming pretty fast. He
broke that's your next step.
He broke the ISL record in the 400.
No.
Yeah.
There you go, man. Right. see, you're in the swim cloud. It's swim cloud right there. You're in that world. You could text that guy and be like, hey, nice swim. And then you guys would show up at a meet and you guys would be boys. So you felt good going into NCs, and then you just kind of popped off and went a 14:27, and that was insane. That's an insanely fast time, second fastest in NCAAs, and swimming's really just developing and getting faster. So you know, after that swim, you know, kind of take us through your decision to redshirt that year, because now it's 2020, we're getting ready for Olympics. And you want to do something serious. You want to take swimming, you know, to the next level. That's your main focus. That's your main priority. Talk to us, you know, going through your decision with your coach, maybe your teammates, with Mark Schubert, and then what ultimately led you to making that decision to come back down to Mission Viejo and train with Mark Schubert and leave Indiana after you just had an insanely successful year. Because that's what I was looking at. I was like, dude, that's kind of crazy. Like, he had such an insanely successful year. Really developed, really blossomed. And then he's like, all right, I want to go back. And you really got to believe, like, you know, I feel like training with Mark, you really got to believe in what he's doing. So, you know, kind of talk us through that and, you know, what the main differences are between what Mark's doing out there and what you were doing at Indiana.
So, I mean, really what started, I was hoping to make the Olympic team in open water, and the team was selected at the 2019 Worlds.
Yeah. But
I didn't qualify for the 10K, which is the only open water event at the Olympics, at the open water nationals in May. So there was that. But like, if I had qualified, I was planning on like taking the gap year then to focus on open water.
Yeah.
But another thing that like played into it was, I mean, I did pretty well short course, but
yeah,
I trained with the IU team the summer before my freshman year, and I didn't do as well as I wanted that summer. So I was just like unsure about how the long, like the training long course wise would be like, yeah, that good for me if I could drop as much as I wanted to.
Yeah.
So I was really, there was that. And then I, after open water nationals in May, I went out and, or I still went out over the summer to go back and train with Mark then, because I still qualified in the 5K.
Yeah.
So I, Mark's training is definitely better suited for open water.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was, that's the main reason I went out there originally over the summer. But a month into the train, I don't know if it was a month or like three weeks in, we had a meet in Irvine, and I was training really well, training really hard, but like, it was an in-season meet. We didn't drop rest, we didn't shave, we didn't do anything like that. And I was 3 seconds off my best time in the mile. And I was like,
wow,
really excited about, like, I was really happy and I was really excited about it. And Mark came up to me after the race, and or like, it was like after we first talked, and he came up to me again later and like said, I think you need to take a gap year and completely focus on swimming so you can like try to make the team in the pool,
yeah,
next summer. So he told me that, and like, I was pretty much like, all right, like, I'll do that. And then I still like took some time to like make sure like I was officially like gonna do that. And then I didn't know if it like let the, or I didn't like officially decide on that for another month until the week before I left for Worlds. So
yeah, wow.
I mean, it's just Mark's training for me, I think, is really well suited for long course and open water. And since the Olympics are in long course, it's like what I needed to do. I really also thought I needed another year, or I needed a year to focus on just swimming, like figure out what's like, because I was still learning like what's best for me and like training, like what benefits me the most, like what I do best at in workouts, what I need to work out on more, like what kind of like yardage I need to do before like taper meets and stuff.
Yeah.
And doing all that. And I thought like the best way to do that was to like take a complete separation from like school also. So I didn't do any school last year.
Yeah.
And being able to focus completely on swimming, like, really was just like very beneficial overall. Like, I like think that was the best decision I could have made, like taking that gap year. So
where do you think that when you took that gap year to train, and you know, you fell short of making the Olympics that year, you're still young, you still have, you know, super bright future ahead of you. It's weird. It's weird saying all that stuff. And knowing we kind of, you know, I don't want to say we grew up together, but you know, definitely there were a couple years there where we trained over the summers. And, but yeah, you're the real deal now. And, it's kind of cool. You really haven't changed. You're still the same Michael I know. You got something growing on your face. But you know, other than that, you're the same person. You're the same quirky. You're still, you know, a kid at heart, which is, you know, so refreshing to see. You know, you come to practice, you still find, you know, the joy and, you know, talking to your friends at practice, and, you know, you're not better than these guys. You know, you're right there with them and doing the exact same thing. So, you know, what would you say the biggest difference between training with Mark is and training down at Indiana? And where you really saw the benefits while you were down here in Mission Viejo this summer, or I guess past summer, kind of. Yeah, I guess it was this past summer.
Yeah. People always ask me that question, and I don't know how to exactly describe it. It's just Mark, we definitely do. I mean, it's not a lot more yardage like overall, but we do more yardage. But then inside the workout itself, like the main set, like how it's set up is, like, you know how we do like thousands, like repeat thousands, repeat 500, stuff like that. Here at IU, like mostly we don't off, I mean, today, like Wednesday, our challenge set day is one day of the week where we really do anything like that. So like, for example, today is 2000s, 2800s, 2600s, 2400s, 2200s.
Yeah.
And that's like, I mean, that's almost like a, I mean, I wouldn't say like average, but like a, if Mark gave us that set anytime during the week, we'd be like ready for it because it's just what he does all the time.
Yeah, it's expected.
Yeah. And so we're doing that just once a week. And then the rest of the workouts, like Monday is usually like 100s, or it's like really anywhere from 50s to 150s, like doing best effort. Tuesdays are like 15. The best example for Tuesday workouts is 15 twos on like anywhere from 210 to 230, like holding a best average there. Yeah. And then Thursday.
On a good day, what would you hold on a set like that?
Averagely, I'd probably hold like 149, 150, and on a good day, it'd be like 47, 48.
Wow, nice.
Yeah.
I would love to see that. I'd love to be that fast. That must feel good.
Yeah, I mean,
you're flying.
Yeah, I got, you know, Marwan Alkamash right now pushing me here, and Zane Grothy, whenever he gets back from the ISL, and Mikey Cavillo, they all push me really well in practice. Yeah. Like, Zane and Marwan usually are beating me on sets like that, and then Mikey's right there with me.
Dude, yeah, you got a really good training setup down there.
Yeah.
Well, I want people to know that, you know, the fact that, you know, Mark does maybe, I don't want to say it's, you know, maybe more distance because it probably is. But there's definitely an expectation level. Like you said, when you show up, you know, at Mark's practice, you know, it's going to, every practice, you know, it's probably going to be hard or difficult or challenging and probably better suited for an open water swimmer. But for the average college swimmer, you know, going up and probably doing less volume, you know, is actually probably pretty helpful for them. But for you, I want to say you're a different breed. You're kind of like, you know who you kind of remind me of, actually? Like a male version, not nearly as good looking. You know, it's Jana Evans. Like you, I feel like you have that connection where you kind of have that engine that doesn't stop moving, doesn't stop going. Your feel for under the water is insane. Like, I wouldn't say if someone were to watch you swim, they'd be like, Michael is so good. He has such good technique. And I'm not saying that in a savage way, but really where it matters is under the water. I mean, if we're being honest, and that's where you got it. Mm-hmm. But you're not like a crazy, like turn specialist. Actually, where do you think you could improve the most? What's your biggest weakness? Actually, let's do that. What do you think your biggest weakness is? And then what do you think your biggest strength is as a swimmer? You know, they say all swimmers are different and kind of have their, you know, their specialties. What's your weakness?
For my weakness, I mean, like you said, it's my turns. I really got to work on getting stronger push-offs. I do like one or two but dolphin kicks, but they're like kind of weak. They're just like kind of there.
Yeah.
And then I breathe right off the wall, and I need like do at least one stroke without breathing so like I can keep my momentum going. And then
you're one of the best
also,
and you still breathe off the wall.
Yeah. I mean, I can get away with it right now as a miler, but I mean, if I want to keep getting better, that's something I gotta change.
And yeah, then, we gotta change that.
And then also, I mean my stroke's short, but when I start going fast, it lengthens out. But also just making sure like I can like have it long throughout the race, keeping like maintaining that distance, and then keeping a like decent kick going. Like I usually have, it's like in between 2B kick and a 6B kick, like a 4B kick going during the race.
Yeah, that's weird. How you get a 2 or 4B kick. That's like an off kick. Actually, I think 2B kind of makes sense. Yeah. A 4B, that's weird. I don't know how you do.
I don't know. It's not like a 2B because like, I'll be kicking and then I'll like have a pause whenever I breathe. So it's not a 6B kick, but it's not a 2B kick though at the same time.
But that's what I kind of mean with Janet though. Like Janet was kind of the same way where if like you looked at her, you'd be like how is, but it really comes down to you just got a super good feel. You work super hard and you're a really talented swimmer. I mean, if you knock down, you know, your turns and all that stuff in between, you know, we're looking at a good 200, 400, you know, you can cover the board. all the way down to
yeah. You know. I still gotta work on my speed though a lot. I'm still a little.
You're not sprint group yet?
Oh no.
What are they thinking down there? They gotta get you in the 1500 next year.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be fun.
I win.
Yeah. We talked to Herbie last week, and we talked a little bit about USRPT. Do you guys do any like USRPT type stuff down there, or is it pretty much straight from the old school book?
I mean, I honestly don't know too much about USRPT.
Dude, you gotta watch the last pod with Herbie.
Yeah.
About it. So you guys aren't doing USRPT down there?
No. I wouldn't say we are. But like Saturday mornings we do like 200 pace stuff, but I don't, most of it's just like, I don't know, like best average or like short intervals. So not too much of that.
Well, so I'm going to educate you real quick. So USRBT, it's just ultra short race based training. Okay. And really what I guess, I don't want to butcher it, but I mean, the basis of it is coming down, you're taking off some of the volume and it's pretty much just race specific. So when you're coming to work out, everything is race driven. I'm curious to see how that's going to take shape in the evolution of distance swimming. But you guys are crazy. Distance swimmers are weird.
No.
Why is that? I was a distance swimmer at one point. What is it with distance swimmers? Why? I feel like every distance swimmer has their thing. Oh, yeah, no, I know you know where I'm going with this.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like you can say that about any of, like, the strokes. Like, they're definitely, like,
different. Yeah, but the distance swimmers are, like, they're always like a little bit quirky and weird. Like when you look at a sprinter, maybe it's just that the sprinters are like super buffed up and they look a little more intense. But well, distance swimmers, like, okay. Honestly, I love this kid to death. His name's Jay Bollinger. I don't know. Have you ever heard of Jay Bollinger? Shout out Jay. He was really, he finaled like junior nationals, I think his senior year of high school. And then I went to college, but he was a distance swimmer. And this is an example. I'm not saying every distance swimmer is like this. But Jay Bollinger would just like post pictures of cabbage on Instagram. We were like, but like, it was just like kind of not a distance swimmer thing. But like, I feel like distance swimmers have their quirks. Yours is small hoodies. You love, can we get the Indiana team to back me up that Michael Brinegar doesn't have a hoodie that fits him? Well, no.
You can say that, ask anyone that though, because the sweatshirt I wear on like any trip I go on, like, anytime I go on a plane, I wear this small red Under Armour hoodie.
Yeah, I swear, it's probably the hoodie you showed up every day to practice down at Mission.
Probably,
it's like, it's weird. I don't know how it does it. It's like, it fits the arms. Well, it's just weird. It looks really small on you, but at the same time, it fits you. I don't know how it covers everything.
Yeah.
It gets you down. It does the job. What are you doing? What's your hoodie secret?
I mean, like,
what size? What size are you wearing down there?
Large, XL sometimes, I don't know.
XL, what? Are you actually a full 6'4"?
Yeah.
You're not. No, you're not. Are you really?
Yeah.
You're full 6. I looked you up on Wikipedia, and it came up as 6'4", and then the sport you do is open water. It's not even swimming. They need to put respect on your name. They need to throw swimming under the Wikipedia profile. Who did it?
My roommate right now.
He did the Wikipedia thing?
Yeah, she did it, yeah.
Oh, she did it?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna hop on Wikipedia and edit it tonight.
Yeah.
It's gonna go out. I'm just gonna post links to the pod. That's how you're gonna get views, man. okay, so you had a really successful freshman year. You came off, you took that year off, you trained for a year, you fell short, still really developed and matured. Now COVID's hit, it's going crazy. The world's all in chaos right now. How are you doing right now at Indiana? How are things? Are you gonna swim this season?
Yeah, I'm swimming this season with IU. I mean, as long as we have a season. I mean, right now, football going on, basketball seeming like it's going to happen soon. I think it will.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the SEC is swimming right now. It's just the Big Ten. Our season's not going to start until January.
Yeah.
And then, but other than that, I had US Open this past weekend. I didn't taper at all, like any kind of rest or anything. It was a little rough.
I think I saw an interview from it. Were you wearing? Were you wearing an Indiana cap?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I saw an interview. I think that's where you said I'm for sure swimming this season for sure.
Yeah.
That was my Michael impression right there.
I mean, the guy kept asking me. He kept asking me about it, and I was like, "Yes, I'm swimming. I'm swimming." Like, Because so many people have been asking me about it, and I mean, I am swimming.
Yeah,
I'm
that's probably so
competing.
annoying. I'm glad I asked you.
But yeah, other than that, I mean, the training's been going like really well. We haven't been doing our full like normal practice schedule. Like we only do, I mean, we still do 3 mornings throughout the week, but usually it's four.
Yeah.
And the mornings are a little shorter too, so it's not the same, but our afternoon workouts are still the 2 hour and 15 minutes. But you know, like I've been training right now the fastest I've ever been training, so it's just
No
been
way.
really good.
How much time
Yeah.
did you take off for COVID?
I took about a month and a half off,
Now, are we
and
talking like a month and a half strict, didn't do
oh,
anything, or like,
I was straight up playing Call of Duty every day,
let's
just
go,
home.
baby. Come on now. Run
No,
it back. Run those stakes.
my parents like had a exercise thing in our basement, and
Oh
then
my gosh.
I tried doing it for like 2 days, and then I was like, this, I can't do
Yeah, I've
this.
done. I've
So
done.
that was it, and I was like, okay, like I'm just taking this time off. Like I'm never gonna get
Yeah.
this. I didn't know how long the break was gonna be, but I was like, I'm
Yeah.
never gonna get this kind of rest again the rest
No.
of my career. So I was
Heck
like,
no.
I might as well take it and enjoy it.
Dude,
And
yeah. I'm so glad you're thinking like that.
then, yeah. So I took that month and a half off, went back out to California in May, and then started swimming with Mark. You know, he said he's gonna, he said he's gonna ease us in. He like kind of teased us that first week, and then after that, it was just like right back into hard training. Like, I
Oh
mean,
my gosh, of course.
I wasn't like in shape, but like his workouts were just like killing me. Like they weren't horrible, but like they were just very difficult to like start getting through. I mean, I didn't start getting back in like good shape until like mid-June.
Dude, I love Mark to death, but his let's get you back in shape workouts suck.
Oh yeah.
They're the worst
I
things
mean,
ever.
they do their job though. They do their job though. They'll get you back in shape, but
Yeah,
man,
they do in like 2 days. You're there. Your body's hurting, but you're there. They'll
Yeah.
make sure of it. That's crazy. Oh my gosh. COVID's been wild this year. Coming
Yeah.
back, you're swimming. Well, that's all good. I'm glad to hear you're training well. And I think athletes need those, little mental breaks. Swimming's like really one of the only sports that doesn't have an off season. I know,
Yeah.
all these people are like, there's never an off season. Sports
Yeah.
always. But football, basketball, like they get an off season. But even if they're just, still shooting hoops every day, it's controlled. Swimming, there's really no off season. So like you're saying, take that month and a half, take that gap. Get mentally right. You're doing crazy amounts of distance. Probably felt good, and you probably feel a lot more refreshed right now. That makes me
Yeah, I mean,
happy. I'm good to hear you're doing well, Michael.
yeah, thank you. You know, it was just, especially I thought it really benefited me in August, or like late July, like right, we were gonna
Yeah.
have him, but then it got canceled. But like going into it, like I was feeling really, really good. And then, I mean, it got canceled then, and then I swam through like mid-August, and I took another week off just to, like get ready for like the training I was going to be doing here at IU.
Yeah, your schedule doesn't make any sense to me, but I'm gonna pretend like I'm following right now.
Oh yeah, sorry, but like so like I was in California then, like up
You don't
until
even
like
have to try to explain it.
oh okay.
No, I'm just kidding. Go, continue.
So like I was training in California like through the COVID thing. I got there in May. I left like August 1st, drove back. I drove back to Indiana. I trained here or trained with my mom's team for 2 weeks, and then
Yeah.
I took a week off, and then started training with the IU team again when everyone else started training. So ever since then, I've been back here training with IU.
Yeah, good stuff. Well, if you look at, did you see what ASU is doing? Like they're redshirting their whole team.
Oh yeah, I remember.
Again, talked to Herbie about it in the pod last week. I know you're about to, well, you already watched it, right? You already watched it.
Yeah, I mean,
Great pod.
I knew that. I just like forgot what you were like. I thought you were saying bring something else up, like they were doing something else or anything.
No, but they're redshirting their whole team.
Yeah,
What do you
I think
think?
that's cool. I mean,
Hot take right now.
I think that's just a little crazy. I mean, maybe right now it's not as crazy with how bad COVID's getting again, but at the same
Yeah.
time, called it. It was just like it seemed really early to be doing that.
Yeah, it's a super hot take. But that being said, I think Herbie talked about it. They only have a couple of returning seniors.
Yeah.
It'd be weird if like there was like half the team that wasn't on board with it. It seemed like most of the team. And well, I mean, you should know, you know, I mean, you know better than anybody, taking a year off, you know, really benefited you. Mm-hmm. And just taking that year to develop. So maybe we'll kind of see a bunch of Michael Brinegars on ASU and see what happens.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like, that's a good point. But, I mean, there's also the kind of, like, not everyone on the team is, like, swimming's their priority while they're at college. Other people are going to have the priority of school, and they're going to be like, once I'm done with, like, my education, I don't want to keep swimming.
That's a hot take right there. That's true. Like, dude, here we go. Here's the beef. We were looking for it. We're finding it. Michael Brinegar is going head-to-head with Bob Bowman right now, and we got a live On The Trade podcast. Let's go, baby.
I'm not saying that, it's surprising that it was just like immediately like that soon, you know, like,
yeah,
because they're like, I have friends on the team right now that it's like, if their season gets canceled now, like, they're just going to be done with swimming because they're like finishing their education. They're like, I don't want to keep going after this.
Yeah, that's hard. It's definitely hard when you have that extra year and you like, do you just keep swimming? And swimming's not really one of those sports where it's like, yeah, for the most part, I know the ISL is really starting to take off, and we won't talk about that much today, but it's kind of starting to offer that professional opportunity, but it's still so limited to so many swimmers. So yeah, I see what your point is. You know, talking to Herbie about it last week, it seems like they got their heads wrapped around it pretty well. But I see what you're saying. Like, that's kind of a complicated situation. But no, it's all love. It's all love for Bob on this podcast. We love Bob.
Yeah. It is a good coach.
Yeah, we're gonna get him on one day. With the next Phelps or the next Michael.
Did you ask me to help you get that podcast with Bowman? Mark and Bowman are friends.
Yeah, no, they're homies.
Yeah.
They're boys. We should get it. We should do a four-way podcast where it's me, you, Bob, and Mark, and then you and Bob can go out your philosophies together. And then Mark and I can just commentate on the back.
Yeah.
That's a good point, Michael. That's okay. Here we go. I'm going to get right next to your face. Okay. Good work. I'm proud of you. Let's go. That's my mark. There's my mark right there. Was that pretty? What do you think?
I mean, did you ever have that after a race where Mark got up in your face? You know, oh, you had dude. A bad race. And
too many times.
Happy. Yeah.
Too many times. But I think I went deep. I went deep with that voice right there. That's Mark. And it's all one for Mark here too. We had Mark on the first show of the pod. Mark's an awesome guy. He expects high expectations, right?
Yeah. Well, no, like, I'm not saying it's a bad thing like that.
No, yeah. We're on the same page. We love Mark.
Yeah.
And he's got high expectations for, you know, all his swimmers. And that's where I feel like a lot of people get confused. Like, when Mark's yelling and he's getting mad and stuff like that, I'd rather have that than a coach that's not invested in me at all.
Yeah,
I
had that experience growing up, so like, I know like what Mark was doing, like what he was like trying to get out, and like, it's way better than what you were saying, just having a coach that didn't care.
Yeah, at first when Mark, like, the first time that he got up in your face, was it kind of scary? Or it's so weird. Okay, so Mark is like this, he doesn't stand tall, he's not like this super big buff guy, but he carries his presence where, like, when he walks up, you know, everything tightens up. You, like, don't want to say the wrong thing. I remember doing the podcast, I was nervous. And, like, I don't even swim for him anymore. I was like, all right, this is the wrong thing. Good to see you, Mark.
Yeah.
Crazy, man. In a good way.
No. Like, he definitely, like, what he does, if you buy into what he wants, like, you'll definitely succeed. Like,
yeah.
It was fun, like, kind of watching it, like, when I was in high school, like, the different kids, like, the kids who, like, buy in, like, wanting to do well, like, listening to his program or doing his program, following it, and the ones who didn't, just seeing, like, the vast difference in, like, the success that they had. Like, the ones who, like, would follow it, like, they had their goal set, like, they come to practice every day, they would go through the workouts, like, give their best efforts, they would, like, be on getting their goals every time. And then there would be the ones who were just, like, wouldn't show up all the time, like, putting like, not 100% effort, like, just, like, there, just being there doing the workout, like, not putting any extra effort in, they wouldn't be close to their goals, and they'd be upset, and, like, you try to explain why to them, they just wouldn't get it.
Yeah, seriously, and like you're saying, I don't get how you succeed in any type of program and don't buy into it. Like, say I'm doing a math problem and, you know, I'm not like fully bought into the formula. I'm like, yo, this, like, I don't really think this formula is right. Like, there's something wrong. Let me try to fix this formula. You're like never going to get the right answer. And that's how it is with Mark. Like, you got to buy into his formula. And once you start to fade from that, with him, it's hard. Coming in, like you're saying, you know, doing sets of thousands, like, you know, 10 1000s or just something ridiculous like that. Like, if you're not bought in and you hear that set, you have to get out. Get out, bruh. Get out. Okay. Dude, I'm so glad we got to catch up with your swim career. This is sick. I feel like it's been a minute since I really got to sit down and talk to you. Saw you at Mission. Yeah. You know, we passed by. I was working. Doing this, but we really got to catch up. It's been a minute. It's been like 4 years.
Yeah,
it has. We called you and you were just begging to do the pod. We're like, all right, fine, dude. We'll get you on. We'll get you on.
No, I was talking to...
Well, yeah, tell us the story.
I was talking to Dylan and like...
That's Wade's brother.
Yeah, it's Wade's brother, Dylan. Me and him play Call of Duty all the time. And you guys were like... Or Wade was like, we don't know who to like talk to next. And I was like, hey, they should like dig me out. I was like, said jokingly. And then Dylan like said it to you guys. And you guys like were like, oh yeah, let's do it.
Dude, we had someone next. We had Michael Phelps. We literally pushed him aside to next week just so we could pull you up.
Come on, for sure.
With the real Michael, please stand up. Please stand up. Who did I just quote?
I mean,
I didn't quote it right.
No, you didn't. It was Eminem.
Okay, thank you. All right, let's go, man. Man of culture. All right, so we're gonna do a little segment that I came up with. It's called Fact or Nah. It's like fact or nah. Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
These are some hot takes here. We're stirring it up in the swim world here. We're stirring it up. All right, fact or nah? Dressel will surpass Phelps as the GOAT.
I mean, I'm not commenting on that, you know.
Oh, no. We got to get an answer.
not at all. I mean, like, you know how people talk about, like, how they want to be, like, they don't want to be, like, the next, like, Michael Phelps or, like, the next Tiger Woods. Or the next, they want to be, like, the next them. I mean, that's something, like, he's definitely doing. Like, he's being the best he can be. Like, you really can't compare those two because, I mean – Dressel's a little more sprint oriented. Like, he can do the 1500, and Phelps was doing like all the 200s, the 100 fly, and then the 400 IM. So, dude, I mean, it's just like two completely different swimmers.
Be careful. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw Phelps or Dressel like just whip out like a 400 at trials. Honestly.
I mean, I think that would just be too much with this program doing a 400 with all those races that I used to do previously. So,
I really like that answer.
I mean, it's just, it's like, you really can't compare them. Like, they're both like incredibly like great swimmers. Like, they're definitely like going to be like talked about as like the greatest swimmers of all time, but you like can't really say like this guy surpassing him or the other one surpassing, or like the other, he wasn't able to surpass him. It's like, you can't compare them really.
Yeah. I like that. That's a really mature answer. I'm going to give you my hot take, 'cause I got a take on it. Will Dressel surpass Phelps as the GOAT? I think you make a really good point. They swim different events. They swim different races. They share some similarities, you know, with, you know, 100 fly and things like that. I think what Dressel's doing now is just something that's, I feel like what Phelps really did for the sport, and also partially why Phelps, I think, will continue to be the GOAT, at least for a long time. But to your point, it's kind of like comparing, you know, LeBron James and Michael Jordan, which, you know, we'll probably talk about. But I think what Phelps did for the sport was he created the next step. He really brought, you know, that evolution, you know, into swimming, where he made swimming a big deal. Like, when the Olympics showed up, it was the Phelps show, you know, hop on the train, shout out the train, but it was the Phelps show. You know, it was the Phelps show. And I think kind of, you know, as the sports developed, so have the swimmers. Because swimming's faster now than it ever has been. And we're taking away some of those tech suits and all these crazy things. So I think it's going to be hard to surpass Phelps as the greatest Olympian of all time, as the GOAT. I think Phelps is the GOAT of the Olympics. I think Dressel could eventually be the GOAT of swimming. And then I think he'll get passed, because I think those guys are meant to get passed up. Like, records are meant to be type of thing. And I'm not saying that's going to ever take away what Phelps did in the sport. But you know what? We'll bring it up right now. But, you know, talking about LeBron James and Michael Jordan, you know, my take is I feel like LeBron James is a better athlete now than Michael Jordan was in the competition LeBron James has had to go against is so much different than what Michael Jordan had to compete against. But at the same time, what Michael Jordan did for the sport is the same thing that Phelps did with swimming. And now I think just people got to feed off that and get better. And that's what we want to see. What do you think?
Yeah. I mean, I think that was a very good take, like very good points, like what they did for the sport versus like what they did in the sport, though. That's like two, that's another like thing together.
Yeah, that's
too,
another argument. You know? We could literally sit here for like hours and just talk about what those guys do, because it's incredible. But you're like right there. You're like right there. You're about to be on that level, man. So get luck. Get ready for the big stage. We're going to have you.
I mean,
on the pod, man.
I don't think Milers have talked about too much about that, though. So.
No, not yet. You got to make it hype, though. Like, there's a thing. I know as a college swimmer, you can't talk about it that much. But we talked about it with Herbie last week. You know, kind of a little gambling system within, you know, not college swimming and college sports. But getting that active, you know, with the ISL. Because I think if you watch the mile and the miles, then right, I think the miles may be one of the best races there is in college swimming. Like a really well swum. Like these guys, they're battling it out for 15 minutes and you never know which way. The race could take a turn at any 50, you know. And in a sense of like a 50 or 100, they're sweet. They're done real quick. And those guys are studs. They're racehorses. But a mile, there's something about those guys. They're just dogs. 15, 16 minutes of just nonstop head-to-head battle. Like, there's respect. And I feel like there's a way that they could get – like, why is, like, you know, 6-7 minute horse race, you know, why is that just as interesting? Like, we could get these guys going. I just think it needs to be done right.
Yeah, I mean, part of it is like, how the meet – like, NBC, they have commercials, like, in the middle of the race. That's just, like, kind of cool. You know, it's, like, it's taking – like, it's making it less interesting in that point. Like, people are like, oh, there's a commercial during it. Like, this isn't that interesting. You know, it's like definitely the most like interesting race. Like, I feel like you can watch. I'm like probably biased saying it, but like, and definitely like since I experienced it, but like getting watching it, it's just like more like entertaining. Like, I enjoy like longer stuff, like being like, I don't know how to describe it, but like, it's just like knowing like that, like you said, like it could change at any moment, but like all the strategy like that goes into the race. That's like what makes it more entertaining than like a 50 or 100, because like races, it's just like you're going and there's no like real strategy to it. It's just like they're giving 100% it's not to say we're not giving 100% the entire time. It's just
that'd be absurd to think that you're just giving crazy 100%. Like, you're pacing, it's a mile, it's a 60 minute race. Like, there's so much strategy. And I'm not saying that you're going into the mile being like, all right, the 13th 50, I'm gonna turn it on. And sometimes that is how it is. But as you're swimming the race, you start to kind of get a feel for your opponents. And I don't know what it is. I can't describe it. But there's almost this, like, feeling of you know where they're at and how much they're pushing. And you kind of know where you're at. And you're just kind of waiting for that point. It's like, all right, I'm going to hit this turn. And now I'm going to make my move because I know they're going to start getting weak. And that's where distance swimming is really exciting. And people don't see that. And I just think, like you're saying, I don't think NBC does the best job of displaying that. I think there is a way that we get the mile height because those guys are crazy. Those are like super extreme athletes. Like what you're doing.
Yeah.
Let's say you're going 20,000 yards a day, like some practices. That's literally swimming a field, 200 football field, up and down 200 times.
Yeah.
Right? Like people don't, if you ever showed up to a football practice and, you know, football, don't get me wrong, super crazy intense sport. But I feel like if coach was like, yeah, we're going to run the field 200 times today. People would look at coach and be like, dude, you're crazy. Well, you show up to practice and people, you know, Mark's like, all right, we're going to swim a football field 200 times. You're like, all right, that's expected. So you guys are wild a little differently. I like that.
I mean, yeah, I mean, like going off of that though, like one of the most exciting races though, like I feel like that's happened, like NCAA was the mile in 2017. It was a four-way race the entire time, and
Yeah.
then dropped like 23s the last 50.
Jeez.
And it was just like, it's like it was entertaining the whole way through, like just seeing like which one of these guys is gonna fall off or not, or like who's
Yeah.
like gonna suddenly make that push.
Because
And
at
it was
that
just
point, it's
like,
just like, who's going to dog it out?
yeah, it was just like, I don't know, like no other race I've ever watched has been like it.
Yeah, that's so sick. Yeah, distance swimming is cool. When it's done right, when it's done right, when you got the right guys in the heat, because it can definitely go the other way. But the Olympics, we're seeing the best guys. We should that should be some heat right there. Okay, let's get on to the next question. Okay. All right. Fact or not, Ryan Lochte will make it to Tokyo. This is a hot take too.
Yeah, I mean, that's just like
Yeah.
a very hard question because like we have so many young people in the US right now who are like coming up and like dropping all these times, and that's a tough one.
Yeah. It's so hard. I don't want to say I feel bad for the guy, but like that whole thing happened in 2016 Rio, and the dude's clearly been hurting. But it seems like he's starting to kind of turn things around.
Yeah, I mean, he, at US Nationals in 2019, he seemed to have had like a really good meet. Like,
Yeah.
I remember he won one of the, I think he won the 200
Yeah,
IM,
probably.
and it was just, you know, like seeing that, I was like, yeah, it was really good. But I mean, you got like Carson Foster coming up, dropping these crazy times, and like you don't know who else is like gonna
Yeah.
suddenly like throw down. I mean, you got Chase Kalich right now, and it's just like
Yeah.
all these other, it's just like,
I'm not
I
saying it's gonna
think that,
happen. Oh,
I
sorry,
mean,
go
I
ahead.
it could, ha I mean, it, I think it could happen, but at the same time, it's just like you asked me to name some of these spots for like some of these events, and I have no clue to be honest, because it's so like really tight races right now.
Yeah, it's so hard because even I don't want to say it, but like you're saying, you could even get someone like Caleb Dressel who shows up at trials and like, all right, I'm just gonna swim the 2 IM just to see what
Yeah.
happens. And then now you're looking and it's like, yeah, who's gonna, you know, you got Chase, Ryan, Caleb, like all these studs. And to swimming's point, it's just gotten so insanely fast. Do I think Ryan Lochte will make it to Tokyo? I'm gonna say yeah, I believe in the guy. It's all love for Ryan on this show. Hit him with a Gia. Do you remember that show? What would Lochte do? That's where the downfall started. I still love the show
I
though. I love the show.
think I watched a couple episodes.
Yeah, it was fun. I love the
Yeah.
Gias. That was like my thing for like a year. All I would just start walking, Gia. That's it. All right. This actually isn't a factor now. I don't know why I wrote it here. All right. Let's just get your hot take. Well, actually, we'll stick it with swimming. The next big leap for NCAA is to add the 100 IM into. That'd be sick.
No,
Really? Why? You gotta have a reason.
I just, I don't know. The 100 IM just like doesn't really seem like an actual event. I mean, they're doing it at the ISL, but it's not like done at Worlds or anything like that,
I
or
think that's
like
like the most fun
Olympics.
event.
I don't know, because like that race is just, it's pure underwater at that point. You know, it's like everyone's going 15 meters off every wall, and then off the breaststroke wall, they're going like past 15. You
That's what
know,
I'm talking about.
it's not a swimming race though. It's underwater race.
Well, then what's different between that and like 100 back?
I don't know. It's just like I don't think they just need another thing for it, like another 100. You
Okay,
know, it's
we
just.
add in the 100 IM and then we add in the 3000, the 1350. Now we're talking, could we do double and then could we get you bought into it?
I think the events they have right now are like good. I mean, like maybe possibly talk about adding 50s, but not 100 IM. I don't think 100 IM is
Wow,
an actual event.
you'll go for the 50s before the 100 IM.
Yeah, for sure. I don't think the 100,
Interesting.
like I don't think the 100 IM is an actual event.
Interesting. But a 50 fly, we'll take it.
Yeah.
All right. All right. Hey, that's fair. That's your hot take. I like it. We want the hot takes here. Are you just going for the hot take? Is this actually how you feel? Okay. All right. All right. All right. Let's get to Let's go. We got one final segment before we're going to hop onto the gaming sticks. Okay, we've named this, you know, Calvin's Corner. Actually, we haven't named it. Every week we talk about discussing a new name for it. And it's pretty much the same game as Fact or Not, except now I just ask you a question and you just don't go Fact or Not. Let's go. What is Michael Brinegar's favorite junk food?
Like, what do you describe as, like, junk food? You mean, like, candy or?
It could be, like, candy, like, chips. So say you were going to go play video games for like 3 hours, then you gotta go to the store and stock up on snacks.
I don't really eat when I play video games.
That's okay, let's pretend you do, though. Okay, or watch a movie or something like that. Like, if you're going to snack up, what are you going with?
A Hershey bar. I like Hershey bars, but, I mean, I can't
really
eat too many of those.
That's the best chocolate you're going to go for, Hershey's? Come on, man.
Yeah, I'm pretty...
I'm going to send you some chocolate.
Like,
are you a chips guy? You're more a salty or sweet guy?
I'd say gummy bears, I guess. You know, that's
gummy bears?
Like, yeah.
What the heck? Disinsumers are weird. Okay. Hershey bars and gummy bears. I don't know if I've ever heard those two combos. It's like, I mean, Hershey bar is good. Gummy bears are good. As your favorite, like, junk food? Fast food counts too. What's your fast food joint?
Chick-fil-A, for sure.
Oh, Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A smacks. I'm all right with that. Oh. Chick-fil-A smacks.
Chick-fil-A sauce, and their shakes are so good.
Oh, what's your go-to shake? Do you just go Oreo? You seem like Oreo guy to me. Vanilla? I should have known. I thought it was Oreo, but I should have known you would have gone something weird like vanilla. All right. Let's go. Okay, what's your favorite Netflix show? Or, like, what are you watching on Netflix?
My favorite show on Netflix is Peaky Blinders.
What's that about? I've never heard of that.
It's like a 1920s like show about like this gang in England as they like they make their way up and like gain more power. It's like really good.
You want to know it's what really... I'm watching right now?
What?
You ever watch the Avatar, The Last Airbender?
Yeah, I love that show.
All right, did you finish Legends of Korra?
Yeah.
I just finished Legends of Korra right now today. As I was preparing for the pod. Yeah. What'd you think? Let's talk about that show because we're both on the same page with the Avatar and Legends of Korra. Let's talk. Did you like the Airbender?
I definitely liked Airbender more, for sure. You know, it's original.
Yeah, it's OG. Aang's the GOAT. Aang's so sick.
Yeah. I watched the first season, like, when it was coming out on Nickelodeon because I was, like, 12 or 13 at the time, I think. So, I watched that first season, and then I didn't know there was, like, a third season until a couple, like, my senior year of high school, and I tried watching the second season. I just didn't like the second season.
Yeah.
Like, originally. And then, like, I watched it again, and I liked it more, and then the third and fourth seasons were really good.
Dude, it's so insane. Yeah, it really takes off the character development, and I feel like it. What's crazy is I've talked to, like, adults about the show, like, real adults. Uh-huh. I'm talking, you know, 30s, 35s. And like real adults, we're talking middle-aged real adults, and like they'll watch the show and they like love it. It's so good.
Yeah,
I was, you know, I get teary-eyed, I'm laughing. And Legends of Korra was good too. Did you finish Korra?
Yeah, I did. The third and fourth season, like I said, definitely. I mean, like, do you know like how the show is set up?
No, tell me.
Like, so they originally were only gonna have the first season. They're only gonna have one. And then they did
Avatar and Korra? Or just Korra?
No, just Korra.
Okay, Korra. Yeah.
And then they did the first season, did really well on Nickelodeon. It was like, all right, we'll let you like do a second one. Smart. And then they did the second one, and it was just like, I think it did like pretty well again. They're like, okay, we'll give you two more then. And that's like, you can kind of see it when you rewatch it.
Yeah.
Like how the first season, like it ends, like that could have been it. And then the second one again, that could have been it, like that could have been and then the third and fourth season, like the end of the third season, they're definitely leading into a fourth.
Yeah, the end of the third one where she like goes like half paralyzed for like ever, there should for sure had to be. Can you imagine if they just ended it after that, like she like she they the show ends with her walking away in a wheelchair? It's like the end. I think they're actually making a live take or live action version.
I've heard about that, but like I've been hearing about that for like a year and a half.
So I know. I hope it's not. Did you see the? Have you seen the live action movie?
God, that was horrible.
That was terrible.
That was like the first movie I ever saw in theaters, and I was like, I don't like that. Like it was like,
yeah.
I was 10 or something when it came out in theaters, and like to that point, like I'd go and watch a movie at the movie theater, and it was like, no matter, like even if it was bad, I'd be like, oh, I enjoyed that, and I like watched that one. I was
after seeing a movie like that, they kind of just butchered. I mean, they didn't even get his name right. He was Aang. He was Aang in the movie. His name's Aang. Yeah. The show's very clear. It's not like there's like a, I feel like there wasn't like a comic book to start. Like, I think the show's an original show.
Yeah, no. Yeah, the show's original. Yeah.
Yeah. And so why are they changing the names and the acting?
And then
I don't want to be a hateful person, but come on now. Come on now.
The way the like bending was done too is like so dumb. The earth bending, like how they, all the movements they had to do, just like make a rock forward. And then how Firebender did actual fire. I was like, that's just like, no.
Yeah, I started it and then I just definitely didn't finish it. But
kind of surprising. Also like an hour long.
Yeah, it's not long. I don't really get it because around that time when that movie came out was like the same time that the other Avatar came out, which was the movie about the blue people.
Oh, yeah.
And that movie was insane. Like the CGI, like Avatar already had hyped his name. All it had to do was just, you know, come through. Some good CGI, some good acting, but I'm ready for Netflix to take over and go for live action. I think that could be good. We'll see though.
Could be. Yeah.
All right. Let's go. We're going to keep you up. Sorry. So Michael's sleep schedule, he just takes 4-hour naps. So he can stay up till whatever time he wants. Just kidding. No, he doesn't do that. Master of sleep. All right. Who's the most inspirational person in your life? It could be, it doesn't, you know, you don't have to give the basic, like, I'm actually, if your parents are listening, I'm sure they'll love it. Shout out the Michael's parents and his mom. Shout out to them. But let's just take your most inspirational, someone that you feel like you've looked at and has really just kind of helped shape, you know, kind of who you are and who you aspire to be.
I mean, Mark Schubert, definitely, though, to be honest. Like, you know, the way, like, what he wanted out of me, like out of workout, like the swimmer, like he envisions that like I'm capable of being, like constantly like believing myself when I didn't, like, you know, like that was just like a very big part. So it's just like something like I try to work towards every day. It's just like what like he thinks I can do, like the capabilities that like sometimes I don't think I have. And he like just gave me the belief, you know? So
yeah, he really definitely. That's really cool. That's a cool answer. And I know he's, you know, you have some awesome parents, but, you know, he has been really a father type figure to you. And, you know, I feel like people don't talk about that side of Mark enough. You know, he's got a really genuine, good side to him. He is a good person. Yeah. I love Mark. You know, he's someone, you know, just even starting this podcast up, you know, first person I call is Mark Schubert because, you know, I trust he's going to come through. You know, he's got a lot of love for his swimmers. He's a cool guy. Love Mark. I'm a big I love you guy. Like, if you're friends with me, I'm going to tell you I love you. I love Mark Schubert, man. He's my boy. Next question. If you weren't a swimmer, what would you be doing? Like, what is the shape of Michael Brinegar's life? If Michael Brinegar is not swimming, what is he doing?
Well, to be honest, when I was 12, I almost chose basketball over swimming.
Dude, Indiana.
It wouldn't have worked out well, though.
You're athletic.
I mean, yeah, but, like, I was, like, one of the taller kids in my class. So, like, I was always the big man. But
yeah.
I'm 6'4". Couldn't be a big man. And like,
dude, you'd be a point guard. That's what you want to be.
Yeah.
They would just train you wrong.
They were training me wrong for sure because all I was playing as was a big man. I was
the center.
They wouldn't let me shoot.
That's like, not fun. Come on now.
They wouldn't let me dribble or anything like that. It was just come like, you're a big man. Do this stuff.
Yeah, that's it. You know what you do? You get the ball and you pull up from three until they pull you. That's what you do.
I mean, they pull you right away, though.
Wait, did you follow the NBA? The NBA draft was tonight, wasn't it?
Yeah, I didn't really
November 18th.
I didn't know what was going on until I saw, like, the first pick had been selected.
I just want to see if LaMelo Ball got drafted. Should we look it up? Do you know who the Ball Brothers are?
Yeah, I know who the Paul brothers are.
All right, this is the moment of truth. Okay. Who was the first pick in the NBA draft? It's turning from a swamp podcast to covering the NBA draft. NBA draft 2020. Are you looking it up right now?
I got LaMelo. It was third.
LaMelo? Who was LaMelo third to?
The Hornets.
Oh, the Hornets? No, they're not. They'd be all right. They'd be all right.
It's Charlotte Hornets. Remember, it's not the New Orleans Hornets.
Oh, that's right. It's not back to CP3. Dude, the NBA is going crazy right now.
Yeah, no,
are you an NBA guy? Shout out the Lakers.
I'm a Pacers fan, so
it's a little gosh. Bit rough. Yeah.
It's a little rough, especially with Oladipo wanting to leave now. So
yeah, the last thing you kind of had going for you was, Victor Oladipo, a.k.a. Black Panther. And then you guys had Paul George, who...
He left at, like, the perfect time, though. Like, he has not been good since he left.
Yeah, what's Paul's thing? What's his deal? He really blew it for L.A. this year, the Clippers.
I think he's just had a rough time. Do you remember his injury?
Yeah, that poor guy. I forgot about that.
Yeah, ever since that injury, it's been rough. But, like, ever since he left, like, he just hasn't been the same still. Like, even then. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, we have to get, like – well, even with someone like KD, like Kevin Durant coming back to play for Brooklyn off – you know, I don't even know. He had a bunch of stuff going wrong with his Achilles.
Yeah.
Just coming off injury, you know.
Yeah.
And then
KD's just different though. I think he's gonna be back and he's gonna be good. Like he took the time, he took a lot of time to be able to make sure he recovered fully.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of good things actually about, you know, his comeback, and I'm excited. But there's still kind of that hype around, you know, a player's return, which probably could put some expectation that doesn't need to be there on the player. Have you followed Alex Smith? Oh my gosh, we're coming way off this topic. But have you seen Alex Smith at all? And do you know his story?
The NFL, the quarterback, right?
Yeah. It's like
one that had a horrible knee injury. Or like the
He had the leg injury, like his Paul George. Yeah, and then he went back, he got surgery to fix the leg, and then he got like a staph infection.
Yeah,
and it was like disgusting, like almost had to cut off his leg. Like his leg is literally I don't even know how he walks around, but he's out there and he's getting reps in the NFL. Like threw for like 350 yards the other day. So there's anyone that can overcome injury. Shout out Alex Smith. Sorry, we're really diving off topic, but that's all right. Okay, this will be our last question, and then we'll wrap up the pod. We'll move the cameras, and then we'll get set up for the stakes. I think we might have to split the clips. I think we might have to put one gaming and a one pod. This pod went way longer than I expected. It's been good having you. It's been good. Yeah. It's been fun. It's been good catching up. All right, last question. If we could get anyone on the pod next, who should it be? Who should we get next on the pod?
Simon Lamar.
Simon Lamar, let's go. All right, let's do it. We'll get Simon on. Maybe next week. We'll see, and then we'll just start. We'll start getting the list going. You got to get all your boys in Indiana. We'll just go through the line. Just get everybody, you know, talking about Michael Brinegar and what he's up to. So, all right, should we call this pod? Should we say it's been good? Let's not hang up because we're gonna get on the sticks. But this has been great. It's been good catching up with you. This podcast is brought to you by Coach's Oats. Make sure you click the link to subscribe. Yo, let's get the fingers down. We gotta get the points going. Click the link below to subscribe. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, click the link to subscribe. All right, let's take care. Take care, y'all. It's been a good episode of The Train.